Good evening, folks. How are you? Hope all of you are doing well. So I figured I'd spend a little bit of time with y'all on here on a Twitter space. First one back from Passover break, which I needed that rest. So the title of this one is Beauty for Ashes. Now, I could obviously go on a rabbit trail, scripturally speaking, but we're not going to do that tonight. The idea came to me when I was thinking about how my children are typical children. They don't like to listen, just like you didn't like to listen. And most children, given enough leeway, they do whatever they want to do and discover the painful consequences by not listening to good advice. Now, as a father, I've always imagined when my children grew up that they would listen to the things that I endured painfully and choose not to do those things. That way, they wouldn't have to feel the same types of regret and, well, misery sometimes. And you think as a parent, and I promise we'll talk about the markets. This is all about the markets, but I'm kind of preface it by saying there's a little bit of a monologue. I wanted to be a father that would have the ability to be able to say, this is what you do not do. Here's what it did to me. So therefore, don't do what it did to me. Wasted time, led to doubt, made me chase things that were unfruitful, but I had to see for myself. Doing many things, pursuing different things, trying to get a result that was just outside my reach or impossible. And maybe sometimes in your development, while learning how to read the market price and how to find your own style and approach, sometimes it feels like you just can't get it. Once in a while, you'll have this flash of understanding, but it's too short-lived. Doesn't stay around long enough. Doesn't linger enough for you to feel confident in yourself. Sometimes you have this amazing ability to see precise entry points, precise draws on liquidity. You can see where the bias is, what it's going to do, how it's going to behave. But it's not happening enough for you. So you go and you pursue something else because you're impatient. You don't want to wait for the thing that you're supposed to be looking for. You chase after things. This thing looks like it's going to go up. You have no real reason why to believe it's going to go up, but you expect it, you chase it, and it hurts you and it burns you. Now, instead of taking that lesson and taking it as a deterrent from doing that again, some of you will do that same thing again, expecting a different result. And you'll get burned again. While doing these things, you don't see the scar tissue that you're creating. You think, I'm going to beat this. I'm not going to change the way I'm doing it. I'm going to do it on my own terms, my own way of doing it. And while there may be something that's been explained to me in a rule-based idea that I have to follow by someone else's instructions, I just want to be a kid. It's like Toys R Us slogan. The markets are not a toy store. And it's not a place where you can be a kid. It's not a video game. It's not a game at all. It's war. And when you set out in an endeavor to try to do something in these markets, using limp noodle logic and infancy. Infancy in your understanding, infancy in your aptitude, and no model. No model at all. No patience. No specific rule-based idea to follow. You just forge ahead and try to find yourself in the chaos. And in the process, you burn your account. You burn your hope. Over time, it burns your desire to want to do this. And it sears in your mind that this is probably impossible for you. And you're slowly pushing yourself away from it. But you have friends online that you made acquaintance with. You're part of groups. You're part of mine. You're in this community. And you tell yourself, I just can't let go of it. I can't do it, but I can't stop. But you're not doing what you're supposed to do. You're not following the rules. You're not following the instructions. You're doing everything but the very thing that you're told to do. And you are burning your house, your dreams, your confidence, the passion that led you to want to do this at all. And you're lying to yourself because you're telling yourself that it's impossible for you to do this. And I agree. It's impossible for you to do what you're doing outside of the instructions that was given to you. Specific instructions. And when you look at your ashes, which you've burnt up, pursuing something that had no logic for it potentially panning out profitably, instead of identifying the lack of control that was required, but you shed no concern in that. You placed all the emphasis on doing it your way. Your way, through a very myopic, limited understanding, infantile, pushing the button, expecting something to finally give you the confirmation that you're doing the right thing by not following instructions. And you won't stop because you want that more than simply following logic that works. That's a discipline issue. That's not a flawed concept, flawed idea, fake concepts, or too rigid of a model. So you'll end up in this situation if you place yourself there, feeling as if you're never going to be able to do this. You're never going to be able to find your way into consistency. The market's going to continuously beat you down. So why keep trying? Why bother? What's the point? Every time you try to do it, it fails. But see, what you're trying to do is outside of what you were instructed to do. What was the model? Were you employing the model? Or were you doing everything outside of it? Because you were impatient and you weren't willing to wait for that model to form in the marketplace. I can tell you, as a younger man, I had that impulsiveness. I was reckless. I did everything outside of the rules. I would sit down over the weekend. I'd write this plan out. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. And with the cares of the world, my job, everything that was going on around me, I don't have time to wait for that thing to form. I think this next bar, because I didn't use candlesticks back then, I think it's going to go up. I think it's going to go down. I was foolish 5 minutes ago, but now I think it's going to go down. That's not following a model. That's being impulsive. That's trading from your gut. That hunch, that inclination that you think you see something that you really never seen before, but you'll lie to yourself and say, yeah, this looks like something I've seen before. And what you're showing is you have no patience to wait for the model. And to dull that ache, that pain of not being willing to sit and wait for the setup to form, for the time of the day for that setup to form, you'll push the button in times of the day when there isn't any expectation for the market to be delivering any measure of precision, demanding that it does tricks for you and pays you for your consideration of it. Like it owes you something. You identified it. You've given recognition to the market, those candlesticks. You've given some of your time. You've placed everybody else and everything to the sidelines, and you've now given all of your attention to that candlestick chart. So now it owes you something. That's a lie. But you believe it wholeheartedly. And you think every time pushing the button outside of the parameters, outside of the time that these setups should form, you're victimizing yourself, causing a learning curve that would never end by doing those things. And if you've never done this to yourself, if you are a person that lacks patience and falls victim to impulsiveness, this is one of the things I talked about many times over the years. If your relationships and the way you conduct yourself in the world outside of trading, it will be magnified in trading. If you are someone that is seeking validation, seeking, well, acceptance, you'll do things that are over the top, expecting to be successful in that. So therefore, you can go forth and bring it in front of other people so they can glad hand with you, pat you on the back. Well done. You're awesome. You're a goat. You're the greatest that's ever done it. In trading, those types of things are the worst for motivating. Now, you might end up receiving those accolades as a result of doing things that are more focused, more purpose-driven, more detail-oriented in terms of following a model, but not trading for the sake of attention, status, recognition, a rush to prove something. That's a very, very dangerous path, especially for a young man. Especially for a young man that has a desire to stand out from the crowd, that has done well in other things, and you want this to be easier. Easier because it's somehow owed to you. The market owes you an easier pathway to consistency. And look, you're a natural. You'll be able to do this without any kind of rules. That's what your subconscious is talking to you. It's telling you, you don't need to listen to that stuff. And that's exactly what it was telling me as a 20-year-old too. You have to have rules. You have to. And if you do not recognize that, and you think that you can just impulsively just press buttons, trade on your impulsiveness and your gut feeling about where price is going to go, no probabilities behind what it is that you're doing, and then ignoring that that is not working, it will put you into a gambler cycle. You keep doing the same thing over and over and over again. It's not giving you the results, but you're not letting go of it. You're going to keep doing it because you accept the fact that you did that wrong then, but you want to sweep it under the rug and go right back in and say, yes, it didn't work that time, but I know it'll work the next time. If you just simply recalibrated all of that energy, all of that focus on the right things, everyone that blows their account, fails at something, it doesn't have to be trading, it could be anything. Everyone that goes outside of the plan, the approach, the playbook, the results are random. You have no baseline to work with then. You're building a new one that's outside of the scope of the rules and outlined process that you should be following for whatever endeavor you're doing. But for trading, you have a model, or you should have a model. And you need to follow that. Stick to the rules. Trust that these rules will guide you and remove all of the impulsiveness, because the rules say, I do this, I don't do that. I can only trade this pattern and setup in between this time frame, this beginning and ending window. You don't trade 15 hours after that and expect the same type of response in price action. You don't do those things. By recalibrating that impulsiveness, but sticking to your guns, because you know if you keep doing it long enough, eventually you're going to get a result that you're looking for. And then by getting it, you think that's a reward for doing the right thing when everything you're doing is the wrong thing. You're trading outside of a model. You're trading impulsively. You're impatient. You're not waiting for the setup to form, because you're having an issue with discipline. You don't want to subscribe to an idea that someone else has walked before you, lays it down in front of you and says, hey, start here. Only do these things. And then you fail it. And you fail it again. And you fail it again. Multiple times, over and over and over again. And it becomes an arm wrestling match. You want to show the teacher that they don't know you. They don't understand you. You're going to be the exception. You're the one that these models aren't built for. You're going to redefine everything. Yeah, I was me too at 20-some years old. So you can imagine how frustrating it is for me to see, number one, my students do that. But also, children that I had high expectations for, that they would see what I'm able to do, and they would want to be better than me. Like, I was expecting my kids to say, hey, you know what? I'm going to do it faster and better and more precise than dad. And here's the playbook. You can do it better than me. You can do it faster than me. You won't do all the things that I hurt myself with. And they aren't driven to do that. Which is, I guess it's proving human nature. Humans, by default, we don't like to listen. We don't like to, well, look at the students in this community. I mean, not everyone likes the long, drawn-out teachings. Get-to-the-point type thing. Because the attention span of a gnat is what social media has cultivated. Nobody has time to learn anything properly. And it's very disheartening to see my willingness to pour myself out even more, because it's my own flesh and blood, and to see this lack, this disregard for the rules that would lead to them doing the very thing that they're looking for, which now makes me question, is it really the pursuit to do trading, or is it the pursuit to say, I did something on my own? Which I can respect that. I mean, anybody could respect that, right? I mean, there's a lot of people out there trading, you know, all kinds of stuff. I mean, I don't subscribe to the things that they do, but they're making money with it, so who am I to say it doesn't work, right? And I can understand the passion that would lead one to pursue an endeavor that says, you know, I didn't listen to what you told me to do, and I still was able to do this. Okay, great. But are you seeing the results that would indicate that you're doing the right things and that you should keep doing what you're doing? Or is resetting and resetting and resetting and resetting and spending money still not listening, still not doing the things that you're supposed to be doing? Is that really the better way of doing it? Is that the best direction? I would argue that it isn't. But I have to hold very loosely these boys of mine. Because if I say the wrong things, I'll turn their interest completely off. And that's what I'm trying to avoid. I'm trying to keep this little ember burning. And hopefully it'll turn into this wildfire that nobody can put out. And they'll be better than I am. When you sit down and you listen to a child, they say, I don't understand why I can't do it. I don't understand why it's so hard. And then you just gently slide a piece of paper in front of them and say, are you talking about this? Are you saying this doesn't work? No. I'm talking about my way of doing it. But what way is that? If you've never done it before, you've never been successful before, you just started, how can it be your way of doing it? You're doing what everybody else has done. Pushed buttons, found out that didn't work. So let's push more buttons and find out that it still doesn't work. And ignore the data that's being presented to you. Ignore the fact that you're not getting the results you're looking for. This is exactly what I talk about in all of my lessons. Having my DNA, having my time, having me right next to them, available to pick my brain, was not advantageous at all. Because pursuing an endeavor on their own steam, their own timing, their own way of doing it was more important. And I can't tell you how frustrating it is. It's very frustrating. These funded accounts, these companies that do these things, I've never had an interest in them, and I generally don't have an interest in them, but I've seen my son work with this, and I'm not going to say anything about the company because, like I said, it's too soon to say really anything, but I've watched my son's account run into certain rules that they have. And when that account would make money, not really make money because it's like I guess it's like a demo. I guess that's what they make you do, a demo, or the equivalent thereof, where you're trying to pass the combine or whatever. And then you get funded, quote unquote funded. Well, they have these rules, and he got stopped out of his trading when he thought he had a cushion. So my understanding, and I may not have this entirely correct, so just bear with me here. From what I gathered, as you make money in the combine account, or when you increase the balance, let's put it that way, because there isn't any money in that. When you increase the value of the balance of that account, these companies, they roll your maximum loss right back up underneath, you know, whatever that fixed percentage or amount is. And he felt that he had cushion. So, okay, well, if you start with 150,000, hypothetically, and you make 2,000, make 3,000, make whatever it is, then you should have whatever that initial cushion was, plus whatever you now put in the account. And apparently, and I might be incorrect by saying this, but from what I gathered from him, it's not like that. So what he thought was a cushion wasn't there. So they said, you broke a rule. Okay. So anger kicks in. He's going to go and do it harder and faster now. More contracts because he has time lost. He wants to make it up. So he's impulsively pushing the button. No model. Not listening. And now he's dealing with more contracts. So I haven't sat down with this. This is one of the things I was going to do tomorrow morning. I wanted to sit down and see how they put this maximum stop loss in. And when you make money, it goes up. It sounds to me, I want to say what I want to say, but it may not be fair. So just bear with me, okay? This is what I'm suspecting right now, but I don't know in full detail, okay, because I only see screenshots, okay? I only see, you know, show me what you have right now. And then there's a login. He does the login. You can see what he's doing and what he's done right and what he's done wrong. He wants to show what he did right, but he doesn't want to talk about what he did wrong. So I had to be very careful because I know how this is going to go. He's going to hit a brick wall. And it's going to be, all right, I tried it my way. Show me what I'm supposed to do. And I had a little small window of opportunity to do that today. So I spent my time with him. I was all over the charts today, but I had to spend time with him. So because of my frustration as a dad, trying to get him to listen and my other boys to listen when it comes to this stuff. It's amazing. They'll listen to everything else. Dad said to this, this is what we're supposed to do. We're not allowed to do this. Don't talk out of character. Be respectful. The whole business, manners, the whole show. So I guess this is their one area they can say, look, we don't have to do this your way. When this is the very thing that you should be doing my way, right? But that's not what I'm seeing here. And it's very frustrating for me and my obsessive compulsive disorder is really having a hard time managing all of it. Like it's, I want them, if I could ever be one ogre overlording over them saying, you're going to do this and you have no other way. This is it. I want my inside of me. I want to be that way towards them. Like I want to exert my dominance as their father in this area. But I know that won't work. It wouldn't work with me if I was their age, and it won't work for them. And it'll do the very thing that I don't want to see happen, which is leave a bad taste in their mouth, and they'll just say, you know what, I'm not going to bother with this. So I'm balancing something very, very delicate and fragile. And they're young men. And young men, you know what it's like. You've been there before probably, and you're probably feeling it right now. You want things to be easy for you. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with wanting things to be easier. But you have to identify doing the things wrong repeatedly against the good sound logic of something that has worked in the past. Don't risk too much. Don't trade more than one contract. Because these funded accounts, I'm going to say this, and I don't need to have any more details to know this is what this is. They exist to fleece you. They already know the statistical probabilities are you're going to fail. You're going to fail. Because you're going to be impulsive. You will not use sound logic with risk management. You're going to trade more contracts. And that's why they dangle that carrot there. You can trade up to 15 contracts. They didn't say trade with 15 contracts. They just said, hey, you can. And he tried. Not once. Not twice. Not five times, six times. Burn, 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 over and over and over again, thinking that that was going to be the answer. Not realizing that that threshold that is so small. Let's play devil's advocate for a moment, okay? I know some of you trading funded companies are listening to me and you follow me. Just hear me out. I'm not spitting in your face or saying what you're doing isn't helping some, because some of my students are actually doing well. But this discussion here tonight is meant to just really place the emphasis on doing the right things as you, as the trader that would use these types of companies. Number one, the risk is too tight. And I know how to trade. If you're saying that you have no chance of succeeding, if you only lose, you know, a couple $1,000s, that ends it. That completely ends it. We're not even talking about 10%. I don't know what the actual figure is because I just don't know. But I know it's not 10%. 10% would be reasonable to say, yeah, you this is no good. That's you've messed up here. 10%, that you should be able to do better than 10%. Not go to 10% drawdown. They're not. None of them are doing that. When I'm trading, if I take a trade that I feel is worthy of a high risk percentage behind it, I can work with 5%. Now, I believe that would fail these funded account challenges if you were to use that and you take a loss at the full 5%. I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think that would fall underneath the umbrella of most, if not all of them. And that would be considered you failed. In my eyes as a trader, that's nonsense. Because that one trade, that one period of drawdown of 5%, that doesn't mean anything in the grand scheme of things. Especially if you're pushing real hard. And I'm not suggesting that anyone should go into these companies or these combines and push real hard. That's the very thing you should not be doing. But my son, he felt that pressure. And the words were, it feels like I'm trapped in this small room and I can't move around. Well, that would be true if you're trading with 15 contracts. It would be true if you're trading with 10 contracts. It's true if you're trading with 8, 7, 5, and you don't know what you're doing. The model was one contract. I don't care what these companies say. You can trade as many as. That is the hook. That's the thing that you're going to reach to when you do the one trade that wasn't really all that heavily leveraged. And you want to fix it real quick. Well, you know, all I got to do is go in there and do 5 contracts and I can get it back real quick. They know that you're going to do that. And it's advantageous for them to see you fail because you'll pay that $99 six and seven different times. And then expect to get you right around that next new month. You got to pay the dues. And the whole time you're seeing all that stuff add up. Is it helping you get more patient? No. It's revving you up to do what? Think impulsively even more. The words were, I got to get this before they ask for more money. But you're feeding them every day. Reset, reset, reset. Not doing what you're supposed to be doing. Doing everything outside of the rules. Not just theirs. Mine. This might sound like something that you've put yourself through. And you should be encouraged to know that even my own children, this is what they're going through. It's a character flaw. It's something inside of you. And these funded accounts, you can't trade with a lot of contracts if you don't know what you're doing and expect to be successful. And I'm just going to put it out there and just say it just like that. So there's no real advantage There's no real advantage to do a $150,000 account when you can do profitable trading with the 50. He doesn't like the idea of doing that. No. I'm going to do it this way. All right, whatever. Show me. I already know how this is going to end. But show me. Daily. He builds the house. He's the builder. He's the architect. He's doing what he wants to do. And burns it down. And because it's so cheap, $99. All you got to do, $99. And it's all gone. You get beauty for your ashes. It doesn't hurt anymore. Everything I did wrong doesn't exist anymore. It's swept under the rug. It only cost me less than $100. Doing the same thing over and over again. When, by simply doing one contract, following the model, taking that piece of flesh from the market movement and stopping, you can't break any rules. He did, what's today, Friday? Thursday, he had a trade on after 4 o'clock. And apparently there's a rule that they say you can't trade after 4 o'clock. Like, you got to close your trades at 4 o'clock. And he did well. And went to target, set through something, and went right to his target, and then found out that that didn't matter. He had to do a reset because he broke a rule about time. Listen, folks, trading in itself is very, very difficult to learn in the beginning. And for you all out here that are trying to rush into these funded account challenges, you're increasing the level of difficulty when you don't have a model, you don't trade with real risk management, real risk and trade management. I don't care what size account that you have with any of them. If you just trade with one contract, you'll never break their rules and you'll make money. But greed and impatience. I got to get through step one. I got to do it. It says I can do it in 5 days. I got to do it. The rule was spend up to 2 weeks. Don't listen to that. It says you can trade 15 contracts. Don't listen to that. What makes this very, very hard for a new trader is the level of drawdown that they permit is stupid. Now, today, because my son was basically looking at me like, this is impossible. Like, it's impossible. So I had to step in, Mr. Possible. I said, listen, let's take a look at what's going on this morning. Okay. You've been doing everything wrong. Let's just go back to this piece of paper here. And what does it say to do? All right, but Dad, I want to do this. All right. We'll do what you want to do as long as it agrees with what's on this paper. Do you agree? Okay. So I guided. I said, now look at this right here. Do you see the chart showing you this? Do you see that that news at 8:30 caused this movement? And at 10 o'clock, we're expecting it to run again. It's going to do what? Well, you as my students know that I was looking for 4180 in ES. I wanted to see it trade there, and how it traded there would tell me how we closed the week. So we sat there, we watched it spike up, watched it work through 4177. NASDAQ plummeting, dollar raging higher. I said, now you have a setup. And suddenly, all the planets aligned. And immediately, just only 36% of the $9,000 that he's supposed to get before he's quote unquote funded falls into his step one phase equity. Now, I don't know how this works because, like I said, I've never had a real interest in it. But apparently they have a rule, or this particular company has a rule, where you can't have more than 40% of the 9,000 made in one day. So I'm assuming if you were to make more money, and I'm saying this facetious because I don't know, but if that's true, like if you make more than 40% of the 9,000 in one day, does that fail you? Does that cause you to break a rule, or they just don't count that and you just got to keep moving? I don't know. But I plan on reading through all the stuff so that way I can sit down with him and hopefully next week he'll do better than he's been doing. But today I told him this is what you're looking for, and when you see it, push the button. I'd like to say that was enough to satisfy him. But no. No. In some ways, it felt like that bolstered the willingness to want to do his own way. Like he somehow saw something new. He learned something new from that. And therefore, that piece of paper that has a simple set of rules that he has to follow need not be concerned with. So what is he exhibiting? A character flaw. Those of you that learn from me and you don't listen to what I'm telling you to do, follow the bias that I'm outlining. This is where I think the market's going to go. And you're fading that. And then crying, sending emails, posting things on Twitter, complaining to other people in videos about me, when you're doing everything opposite and then struggling and then trying to find the blame on me or something outside of yourself. That's nonsense. You have to snap out of it. You have to snap. You can't do those things. Number one, the world isn't going to let you do that. You'll have a rude awakening. You can lie to yourself in your trading, but eventually you're going to have to see that person in the mirror, and it's going to hurt when you have to come to grips with you're burning it down. You're the one holding the gasoline. You're the one who has the lighter in your hand. You're doing it. Each time. You're doing that. You're causing that fire that causes more damage, and everything has to be rebuilt all over again from scratch. But it's not just a reset. You're bringing something new each time. Depression, fear, concern of how many more you can afford. All those things you're bringing into that new reset. It's not just $99 anymore, is it? It's really expensive. Really expensive. And each time, it's going to get harder and harder. Because at some point, you're going to start doing the math on how much money you've thrown into resets and how far you're behind. See, when you first start, if you're new, you've never really put any money in the marketplace, the idea seems novel. It's wonderful. Like, hey, wow, you know, this is an opportunity for me to go in here and not really use any of my money. And then suddenly you discover you put a whole lot of your money into it, one reset at a time. Every new monthly due payment. And you want the maximum. So you want to give them $400 a month while doing nothing right. And you build up a list of resets, each one costing about $100, and not making anything. Not even getting to, what is it, step two, where you're considered funded. All that money being wasted, all that time being wasted, and all of that scar tissue being created in your subconscious about what it is that makes you a trader. And it's interesting. It's almost impossible for you to recognize that what you're doing is wrong. You're telling yourself what you're doing is right. It just has to be done longer and it'll start working. If you just recalibrated that tenacity, that hoopfa, that moxie, that thing that just says, I don't care, I'm doing this. If you applied that to a model that works with sound logic, you're invincible. You're invincible. Doesn't mean you won't have losing trades. It means even with losing trades, you're not going to deviate. You're going to stick to what works. It's proven itself to you. The back testing has proven it. I have proven it. I've shown live, this is what it's going to do, and it does it. This is what time it's going to form, and it does. But if you're not going to reach for that logic, and what you're doing is costing you money and resetting and frustration and becoming more and more agitated by not following the rules, imagine what would happen if you started following the rules. If you just simply did what you were told to do, how much easier would it become? At some point, you're going to have a whole pile of ashes. And you'll be sitting there looking at all the things that you've wasted. Time, energy, and money. And when you really sift through those ashes and honestly see what you've done, you really didn't use what I taught. You really didn't listen to the lectures and the advice about what not to do and what to do. You really didn't do that. But hey, look at that pile of ashes you got. You were doing something. You weren't wasting time studying, right? You were doing something. And the something you were doing wasn't profitable. And that weighs on you subconsciously. And over time, it'll make you toxic. And you'll start being spiteful. Not to yourself. You won't hold yourself accountable, but you'll point the finger at everyone else. Your friends, your family, me, our community, trading in general. Because it hurts too much to identify the fact that you did this to yourself. Nobody guided you incorrectly. You did everything wrong and you made those decisions. Are you in a position to be accountable for that? Where you can say, yep, if I'm being honest, I made these mistakes on my own. Nobody told me to do that. I did it on my own. Because that's what a trader is. It's a person that says, I own my results. Good or bad, I can live with myself because I'm following a model. I have a rule-based idea that I'm going to stick to that allows me to be objective. I'm not going to be swayed by my notions. I'm not going to be swayed by the psychological impact of what other people think I should do and how I should trade. Look at social media. I was gone for today. And I'm seeing people argue about me when I have said nothing. People are upset with me and I haven't done anything. Now I can cause a bunch of chaos and I don't mind if they're talking about it then. But if I'm not even around, if I'm staying in my own lane, focusing on my family, you know, people, you know, it's not fair that I gotta deal with you. I haven't done anything. If it's not that, it's somebody else out there pretending they created something when they just rebranded something out of my core content. Yeah. That's what the ghost has said. So I'm aware, obviously, that I have students. I'm interviewing them, obviously. And I have several more I got coming. I was going to do one today. I had asked a gentleman to let me know if he was going to be available today at 1 o'clock. And obviously, my family took precedence, and I wasn't able to confirm that. So I'll have to do that next week. But I have three of them scheduled next week for a sit down and recording, so I'll stagger them going into the future, releasing them, but they all know that they'll be sitting with me talking. And they've done things like these funded accounts, and they've made money. So what I'm saying here tonight, don't let it discourage you if that's what you're doing or plan on doing. But I think that if you are going to go that way, one contract, is all you need to do. If you can't lose $3,000, that's your max loss. And each point or handle in the ES is $50. If you're trading with more than one contract, you are exponentially increasing the rate of impossibility for you to succeed long term, because you're willing to take on the larger risk because the payouts are better. I can get more money faster. Well, that could happen. That could happen. I'm not saying it can't. But what also could happen is you could be human. You could be a little off on the day. And the market could also behave just a little bit squirrely. Do something just a little bit unexpected and color outside the lines that you thought it was going to stay within. And the day that you chose to do 10 contracts stings and takes a little bit of your backside off. And then you got to correct all that. And it now becomes, oh, I'm further away from the finish line. Now I got to fix this. Whereas if you trade one contract, regardless of what size account funding you have, one contract, that's a lot of wiggle room. If you only lose $3,000 and you're trading with one contract, you can be horrible in your precision. As long as you're right on your draw and liquidity and you're trading in the right time of day, you can still eke out profitability. You don't need precision. But you have to have precision. Like my level of precision, if you're trying to trade 8 contracts or more and you can only lose $3,000 or you burn it, most of you listening aren't in that skill set. And that's not a knock against you and me saying I'm superior here. I'm saying that the parameters that they're trying to place on yourself, you may not be versed in trading, know yourself well enough, and maybe not even be able to do a precise entry continuously over and over and over again because you haven't done it long enough. You haven't identified when it's not likely to be as precise as you would hope for, which is what I'm trying to teach this year by mentoring with live data, teaching you how to read the tape. So why would you want to increase the likelihood of burning everything down just to have one good, quick run? I got to step two real fast. Oh, well done, you gambled. Well done. There's a lot of people that go to Vegas and they make money. That doesn't mean they were skilled. You want everything that you're doing in this industry, in this endeavor, this pursuit of excellence in trading, to be that very focused there. Excellent in excellence. You want to be able to focus on being good at what you're doing, not showing up at the right time and getting lucky. You don't want happenstance. You don't want coincidence to be the common denominator in your success. That's not what you want. But if you're being honest with yourself, that's what you're asking the universe and fate to come into your favor when you're over leveraged, just trying to get through to step one. That's what I've watched him do. I've watched him push and push and push and just try to get through it real fast because it took him longer. He's speeding up more intensity and more fever to do everything backwards still because panic has set in. And I just sat with him and reminded him today that there's no reason to feel that way. Think about it. You're going to pay this monthly due to whatever that company is. So why not just give yourself the full month? Does that make you a bad trader? Does it make you less of a trader than someone else? Who cares how long it takes them to do it and what they think that it should take you to do it? Because when you get funded and if you make money and you do whatever those profit splits are, which I don't even know what the profit split is. I don't know. But whenever that is, and whatever that payout is you get, are you going to listen to that same person that's telling you what you should do, how you should do it, how fast you should do it? Are you going to let them tell you how to spend it? No. So why are you going to listen to them when they tell you what you should be doing to get through it, a specific time frame or duration or model or approach to doing so? All these things are distractions. They're all ways to keep your eye off of what it is you're trying to do, which is find consistency, stop burning down things, and receive beauty for ashes by doing what you're supposed to do and focusing on that, not trying to rush it, not trying to add 20 funded accounts. Let's just start with one. Let's just start with one, trading with one contract, giving yourself time. Okay, I know some of you are thinking, wait, Michael, wait, man, wait. Listen, you said one contract, but they're asking for $400 a month. Come on, man, I can't get rich on that. They're in my pocket. They're going to be taking a portion of the profit split on top of that too. It ain't worth it then. It's not. You have to turn these odds around and place them in your favor. You got $3,000. $3,000 drawdown with one contract, that's a lot of wiggle room. That's very forgiving. And to make $400 over the course of a month with one contract is easy. See, you don't know it because you're trading with larger leverage every time you're trying to do these combines to get through it real quick. Because you probably told yourself, all right, I'll break all these rules to get through it. I'll trade with 5 contracts. I'll trade with 8 contracts just to accelerate my way through step 1. But when I get to step 2, I'm going to be a good boy. I'm going to trade with no more than 2 contracts because it would be silly for me to lose step 2 funded by over leveraging. But you're not using that same logic going through the first part of it. Silly, isn't it? And this is really no different than what people do with their live accounts. Before they even send the money to the broker, they're like, I'm going to file all the rules. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. And as soon as the accounts opened up and you had the first losing trade, oh, well, that went out the window. What'd you say? The casino never closes? Well, that's exactly what I'm here for. Push it. What's the most contracts I can trade? That's what we're doing. All logic goes out the window when you're using real money. Which is why I tell you, you have to be bored with the results in demo 6 months. If you just do it for a month, you're not really desensitized. You're not conditioned. You're not initiated. You just dabbled. That's equivalent to anybody else that starts in Forex or trading and they use a demo account. Oh, wow, I could have made money like that. That sounds like a plan. Well, let's go ahead and just put $5,000, $10,000 into an account. I'm probably going to make money. It doesn't work like that, does it? Suddenly, there's a scorecard and it has a dollar sign right in front of it. You don't want to do all the wrong things multiple times and realize over the course of a month, none of the things that you did panned out. None of them resulted in step 2 funded. That's frustrating. You trade with one contract. I don't care who you see live streaming making money. You don't know if they're resetting accounts. You don't know if they're really trading with a funded account or trading with a practice account. He took trades. He thought he was in the compound account. And turns out it was in a practice account that he didn't ask for. He did a reset early on. And then when he logged back in, it apparently defaulted to a practice account. So he was working with that account, made a little bit increase, and come to realize none of that was even going towards the combine. So you can imagine he was a little torqued up about that. I mean, I did everything I could not to laugh, but, you know, it is what it is. I mean, you're going to do silly stuff. Sometimes in the past, I pressed buy when I wanted to do sell. You're going to get disoriented. You're going to do silly stuff. Okay, but imagine doing work thinking you've gained some ground and it wasn't your live account. It was in a demo, that type of thing, right? So I think he's learning that all the things he's trying to do aren't going to work. And I'm hoping that this coming week, he'll get hammered more and finally just say, that's it. Like, I can't do it this way. I'm only going to do what you said. And I'll be satisfied. I'll be happy. Because I know that will yield him what he needs to build back, improve and repair what he's done to himself, and then replace it with positive reinforcement. And all that little bit of stuff he's done to himself will be just enough to remind him not to do it. Just a little bit of scar tissue. Just a little bit. That's healthy. But when you constantly just keep going, I have students that came to me that tried to do other people's way of trading and such. And they've spent like $8,000, $10,000 in all of these funded account companies, hopping from one to the next and just paying all these things. And never one time got to a point where they could be in a position to be funded. So what's the point of doing this then? You should have just took that money and put it in a live account. Because you basically did the same thing. If you're not going to follow rules, just flush it away anyway. But see, you're tricked. You're thinking, it's only $100. I can take this trade and over-leverage it. Because what happens if it works? I'm only really risking $99. That's what you're thinking, right? Because that's exactly what he was saying. And you are hooked like crack. I might not win, but I could. It's like the lottery. Everybody's going to be out there playing these lottery games tonight. $400 million for the, what do you call it? One of those big games. It's supposed to be $400 million. Everybody's talking about it today. I was going into 7-Eleven. And the lady comes out and she goes, "Don't worry, I got the winning ticket right here." Like, okay, I didn't ask. I'm going in there to get milk. See you later. The mindset is, you know, the chances of you winning that is next to zero. So many degrees, it's you're not winning. Let's put it that way. But people still pay to play that. Because the idea is, yeah, the odds are so far against me, but it only costs me a dollar. Now let's take a step back. Nobody's getting rich on that $1 being spent. And these funded companies aren't getting rich by your measly little $99. But they are getting rich with the masses that keep doing that same thing, just like the lottery administration. It's in their advantage to give you the freedom and rope to hang yourself. But they didn't kick the chair out from underneath you. So they're not the bad guy. They laid a single round of ammunition on a table in front of you. They laid an empty handgun on the table in front of you. They made this Russian roulette available for you to play, but you decided to pick the bullet up. You placed it in the chamber. You spun it and put it to your head. Whose fault is it when you pull the trigger? What consequence and result after you pushing that trade, doing that thing that you did? Who's going to have the responsibility when that trigger's pulled? Not them. Their hands are clean. They're getting paid. And they don't care if you go away because there's going to be someone else that's going to jump in their spot, your spot, everyone else's spot that says, "I'm tapped out. I can't afford to pay anymore." That same, I might not win, and there's a lot of things saying I can't likely succeed doing this, but if I win, I can get through the step one faster. Like that's somehow going to change your level of discipline, personal responsibility. And now you're going to suddenly follow the rules? You won't. Because now you're going to say, "Well, listen, I just took 10 contracts and I made $1,500 on three handles, which seemed like seconds. It only took me seconds to do that." Well, let me just go in there with my live stage two funded account. And I can just do that every day. That's not the model. That's not the model. You're going to make every excuse to do the wrong things. Like a married man that caught the eye of another woman that he knows he should not talk to. He knows where she's at, and he's making excuses. Honey, we need bread. No, I got bread today. All right, well, I'm going to go get some soda. What do you need soda for? I don't know. I'm thirsty. You're doing anything you can to get out of the house, to go find yourself in the position to be in that step two funded position where you can over leverage and play Russian roulette with a hoochie mama. That's human nature. That's a character flaw. You're inviting chaos. You're asking for it. In this case, you're buying it. You're paying for it. And while they may make available all these things, if you don't do the right thing by having less leverage, don't give them the opportunity to see you fail so quickly and easily, because they know the majority of you are going to over leverage. They know you want to get to the part that makes money. And they have a 90% likelihood that you aren't never getting there. And even if you did, and you get lucky, maybe one payout, oh, great, great. Your greed's going to tap you there and say, okay, I need to make more. Or I need to go quicker this time. All they have to do is sit back and let circumstances be what they are. Recklessness and chaos shows up. And for a period of time, for those that are getting lucky with it, ego is going to be that friend that leads you to ruin. I'm always going to be able to make money now. Look at me. We are. And unfortunately, that kind of mindset leads to ruin. So don't invite it. Don't make it about a spectacle. Don't make it about over-the-top types of results or Olympic-sized feats or speed at which you get to stage two. Take your time. Relax. Just relax. One day, like today, anybody that uses what I'm teaching could get funded to stage two in a day like today with one contract. That's not impossible. One contract that could have been done today. But you're looking at a move like today, and you're thinking, if I had five contracts here, and five contracts here, and five contracts there, yeah, you could have. It could have been like that for you. But do you have that experience yet? Probably not. So don't have your expectations so high and lofty where it's easy for you to fall and not feel like you can do it. In other words, don't set yourself up for more than just a temporary failure, because traders and trading is a lifetime of failure. How you deal with that? I ask that question in all my interviews now. You know, how do my students that are funded and consistently making money, how do they deal with losing? Everybody does something different. Some people take it harder than others. Other people say, well, you know, it sucks, but I ain't worried about it. I'm going to do the next trade because that trade didn't lose enough for me to feel like I've been beaten. Now, contrast that with, I'm not going to stick to a model. I'm going to over leverage. I'm going to keep pushing and pushing and pushing because it only cost me $99 to reset. Aren't they saying the same thing? No. The trader that has a model is taking very small calculated risks that sometimes does not pan out. And that small loss is insignificant in the grand scheme of their entire career as a trader, as a speculator. And they're not worried about trying to avoid the losing trade because the model and the rules say, do this. And this is what should happen. If it doesn't, you're not abandoning that model because it didn't pan out for you, that transaction. And the loss was insignificant. It will not have such a weight on your psyche. So that way, when you look at price action, you won't be thinking, this is generally, in other times, this is a trade I would be taking. But I'm going to wait for confirmation now because I have to make sure. Why? Why would you feel that? Because you've taken a loss that's larger than you were comfortable with. If you're trading with a quote-unquote $150,000 account and you're using a five-handle stop loss on one contract, you're risking what? $250. That's not $3,000. That's a very, very small, insignificant amount. So it gives you wiggle room. How many five handles form over the course of a week? Lots of them. Some form at specific times of the day that are very predictable. You don't trade 30 minutes before midnight, New York local time, because you're done playing Xbox Live with your buddies. And now let's go see if I can do something in the market. You don't do that. You have business hours. You stick to them. Bank of America is not open 24 hours. Okay, they have banking hours. You don't want to create this atmosphere in your trading where you feel like you have to always know what the next move is going to be. Narrative is understanding what the algorithm is going to do in price next. It is not an every second of the day narrative. The narrative is when we go into New York session, during this period, I'm looking for the algorithm to do a specific thing, behave a certain way, present an opportunity like the fair value gap, drawing to liquidity. That's a simple rule-based idea. It's time-based. Why would you want to complicate that? There's nothing easier than that. There really is nothing easier. Oh, you can just follow a moving average crossover. Okay. What time frame? What's your entry mechanism? Where's your stop? What are you reaching for? What's the target? See, yeah, I can play devil's advocate just like anybody else. And I can say something, and when I've said it, you have the luxury of coming back and saying, but what about this? And what about this? And what about this? So I cancel all that by sitting in front of you with a live 1 minute candlestick chart. And I tell you what's going to happen next. So all those other straw man arguments can't be used. We're all looking at that hard right edge. And you don't want to take these perfect opportunities to do all the wrong things, waste time, waste money, build up frustration, and now fear. Fear. When you first wanted to learn how to trade, were you scared? No. I mean, obviously you said, well, you know, sometimes you might lose money, but let me look into it further and see what's happening. Because you're convinced that if you look hard enough, you would find a way to never lose money. Let me remind you, that doesn't exist. But when you first started and you wanted to get into this industry and find out more about it, you felt like a child on Christmas Eve. Like you couldn't wait to get more involved. And that's what it's like when students come to my YouTube channel. They get their hands in something like Model 2022, which is a hit the ground running approach. If you're brand new, you've never gone through any of my videos, 2022 model, there's 40 videos. That's where you start, because that right there will give you a 100% right now. Go into the charts and see it every day. You don't need to know anything about price action. Everything that's discussed in that 40 video series will give you enough to know that if that doesn't convince you that there's worth and value in what I'm teaching, if you don't see it there, don't waste any more time with me. Just move along, find somebody else, and I wish you good luck with it. I promise you, if you don't see the value in those 40 videos that communicates precision, time-based ideas, things that repeat, a logic of knowing where to get in, where's your stop loss, where do you take partials, where's your target, done. That's a complete 100%. Everything you're looking for when you buy a course, everything you're looking for when you join a mentorship, everything you're looking for if you're trying to buy a book that supposedly tells you how to trade, that's everything. That's a one-stop, one-shop. There it is. And if you like that and you want to dig deeper, then go into the core content and all the other lessons I have on the YouTube channel. At whatever pace and whatever direction you want to go. Because you'll have something that you're going into the charts, backtesting and looking and studying, whether it be in old moves or real time. Because that 2022 model is perfect. It's pure. It's easy. It may not be easy for you when you're brand new because there's a lot of things you have to understand. But spend time with it and you'll see right away that that is the easiest thing there is in trading. And it checks all the boxes that you would want for precision and algorithmic theory. There's nothing to guess about. It's logic. It's not flawed. It's proven. It makes money and other people are making fortunes with it now. Yeah, I said fortunes. Six figures, in my opinion, that's a small fortune. We're not talking about Mickey Mouse, you know, dollar menu wages. That's a significant amount of money. It's a respectable measure of money. We're not talking about $1,000 and $500 here and there, which is still, in some people's eyes, valuable. If you made an extra $500 a month, and that's all you could do, would you say, I don't want that $500? No, you wouldn't. So it's all about perspective. What you're looking for, you'll find it here. I'm not going to sugarcoat anything for you. I'm not going to pull any punches. I'm going to tell you it's going to be hard. It's going to take longer than you want it to. And you're going to learn in a setting that makes you no money. That's exactly how you want it. Doctors don't go out there and ask people to come off the streets and say, I'm studying for my exam tomorrow. Can I cut open your abdomen and remove your spleen? No, that's not happening. They use cadavers. Okay. So think, do you want a surgeon that has never did any kind of cutting at all on a body to put their scalpel into you? Nobody's going to feel safe with that. So what experience do they have if you're the patient one that they're going to now treat? You're patient one. You don't know this. They're not saying, hey, nice to meet you. Congratulations, you're my first patient. I've never done surgery before. So what time do you want to come in? No, I'm out of here. See you later. But why would you expect anything different with your trading? Like you're that surgeon in trading. You're that doctor. I'll have to remind myself about, you know, people are asking, why am I calling everybody doctor? I'll just say it now, because if I don't say it now, I'll probably forget about it. My ninth grade year in high school, I had a civics teacher. One of the coolest cats there was, man. He kind of reminded me of Martin Luther King. And he just was just real smooth, man. Just real smooth. Came in smooth, like he just scooted around, scooted through the hallways, scooted across the classroom. Sharp as a tack, really witty. And every time we would come into his classroom, every gentleman that came in and greeted him, he turned to him, small little smirk, doctor, doctor, doctor. And that was one of the coolest things I saw. And it made me feel cool when he would say it to me. And I could see the expression on the other students, got, you know, their face would, you know, it would cause them to smile. And it resonated with me and it stuck. In my ninth grade year, and now when I greet my friends or associates that, you know, that work with me, that's where I do it. To me, it's one of those cool things that I saw someone that I looked up to, and it just resonated with me. Much like you all try to talk and sound like me, because I've made an impression on you. Well, that's where I came from. So when I'm doing my interviews and I'm greeting them, that's where I came from. That's where that came from. So anyway, you're going through this process of learning how to trade. You're that surgeon in development. So learning how to do this in a condition where you can't cause any harm. The surgeon that's learning how to do a surgical procedure on a cadaver, are they afraid that they're going to put the cadaver in the ground or kill them? No. That body is dead. It's been submitted to the Department of Science, and they're making that body available to do whatever they want to do with it. That's a cadaver. So a surgeon works with a once living person, but no longer is living. It's expired. That body is lifeless. And they get to have all of the advantages of cutting on a real body, feeling the restrictions of certain types of tissues, even with a scalpel. How to navigate inside of a cavity of an abdomen or a rib cage or a brain without the risk of loss. In trading, you want to learn how to what? Navigate the marketplace and engage without having loss. Do you think the surgeon's first procedure on a living person, do you think they're calm, cool, and collected? No. But they're going to lean on all the experience they gathered with cutting on those cadavers. When they were doing their case studies in the textbooks, writing out their ideas, that's not the same. That's just you writing out your model. But then when you go to that cadaver, which is a demo account or paper trading account, you're doing the theory in a setting that can't hurt you or anyone else. That's proper learning. You're doing it without any concern, psychologically or emotionally, about the outcome. You're focusing on doing what the theory suggests you're supposed to. What's the process? What's the protocol? You're following that. That's your model. Don't let anybody make fun of you and make you feel like, oh, you know, I'm learning how to do this with a demo account. It doesn't matter. Your results are going to be yours. If your results are going to be unbelievably, you know, successful, there's going to be a lot of people that are going to say that it ain't real. And are you going to care? Are you going to care when you start making real money if people don't believe that how you learn was a good or bad way? You don't care. I have more students that aren't on social media because they're off doing their own thing now. Look at the young people that are making themselves available to you in these interviews. They don't have to do those interviews. They're interviewed by these companies. I don't own those companies. We don't have some kind of conspiracy together. I mean, you've heard me talk really in a very low-key anti-approach to funded accounts, if you heard what I was saying earlier. Like, I'm not a fan of them, even though I have profitable students that use them. I'm not a fan of them. That's why I will never do business with any of them. I will never have an affiliation with them. I will never say, go and join this funded account and blah, blah, blah. And here's a 20% off type thing. I don't want affiliations. And when I tell you something, it's my honest opinion. No one has influenced me. They're not paying for my opinion. I will never have my opinion paid for. And I never represent no broker whatsoever. Period. I'm not an introducing broker. Anything I tell you, it's my opinion. And I'm not monetized with that opinion. And that's why, unfortunately, my opinion isn't liked by a lot of other folks, because it infringes on the comfort they hold with their affiliations. And I don't have a problem with them having their affiliations. Listen, get your money, man. But don't hold me to that same level of, well, he must be, you know, in partnership with somebody else. I'm not. So I'm out here sharing my opinion. And it doesn't mean my opinion's right. It's just my opinion. You may take something I say and get a hair up your backside and say, well, I'm going to use this as a reason to prove ICT wrong. And then you create something entirely new. And that would be amazing. So it's not meant for me to be a reason for you not to do funded accounts. I'm just saying that everything that I felt most people would encounter, my son's experiencing that. So I'm, in many ways, I feel vindicated. And the only way I think he and anyone else will do well doing it is by never really over leveraging. Never really doing that. Trade with a very small number of contracts, even if they give you the freedom to do more. Because you're really not trading with $150,000. You're trading $3,000. And $3,000 is undercapitalized, grossly undercapitalized. And anyone that says other than that is full of grade A cow patties. It's just the way it is, folks. Drawdown is a real part of trading. And when you burn your funded account and you burn your funded accounts, you'll feel like, well, I'm going to go back in and I'm going to be a little bit more selective, but I'm not going to change anything I've done. If over-leveraging is part of it, you're going to fail. Just give it enough time, you're going to fail. If you listen to my students and other people that do this, they build up these, well, they have like a deck of cards at their disposal. Multiple funded accounts, multiple ones, because it allows them to have a card to play when one's roasted. When it's burned, they can't use that one anymore. They have something else they can lean on. How about just have one account? Don't over leverage it. Don't demand more than it's going to pay out. Make enough money to go with a company like AMP, where it offers you real trading, very, very low margins. My son had experience with that company. And hey, it is what it is. You know, no broker's perfect. No broker's going to be perfect. You're going to complain about all of them. But that's the world, man. Like, you're not going to have a silver lining that's seen by everyone in an agreement. You're going to have your favorite things about a broker, and you're going to have these pet peeves that you don't like about them. Everybody's going to have that because they're the middleman. But I don't think your best interest is suited for only viewing funded accounts. And I've said, I just don't believe that segment of our industry is going to be allowed to stay around in the capacity that we have it right now. And that's the reason why they're, you know, doing what they can to get what they can from whoever's willing to give it to them. Because the time is probably limited for them to do what they're doing. So if you're going to do that, do it the right way. Don't over leverage it. Make what you need to cover the costs and build up enough money to go with a real broker that allows you to trade with real funds in a real account that allows you to have more drawdown, like in the real world, greater than $3,000. Because $3,000 is nothing. Literally nothing. I spent $3,000 this morning just shopping for things that would never really cost that much 5 years ago. But if I want to stock up on stuff, you know, that's what it costs now. But $3,000 in trading, you were really undercapitalized. And you're paying monthly dues to be undercapitalized. And you can't trade past 4 o'clock when, hey, you know, sometimes earnings season, you'll see moves that are after hours, right? You'll never be able to capture any of that. Now, is that a deciding factor that should keep you from doing funded accounts? Probably not. But it's something that a real brokerage account doesn't place a limit on. So, just food for thought. I could have him in a stage 2 funded account like that. No problem at all. Easy peasy, lemon squeezy. But he's going through something. And I have to let the natural order of things push him to a point where he has to identify what he's doing isn't going to work. And today I proved that what I teach and what I do does in fact work, even in a condition where you think that what you're doing will eventually materialize in the outcome you want. You probably don't have the resources, the patience, or the money to keep resetting until that thing unfolds like you hope it will. I mean, he won't ever run out of money. What he'll run out of is trust in what he's doing is going to lead to the result that he's looking for. And I'm trying to let the natural process that everybody goes through this, some more than others, some much harder than others, some are more stubborn. I was very stubborn. I wanted, you know, and I've said many times, they name streets after me one way. And I wanted to have it my way. My way. And if I'm teaching, you know, you can't come here and expect me to teach you a different way than I'm willing to teach. You know, it isn't your way mentorship. It's my way. And if you don't like how I teach it, you know, nothing's keeping you here. I mean, you can learn how to trade from somebody else. There's other stuff out there that works. Just have good money management. I promise you'll probably still make a little bit of money. But you're still going to lose. And whatever you use to find profits, you know, whatever religious faith you want to place behind whatever it is you're doing, you're welcome to have at it. Be rich. Good luck with it. It isn't going to change what I view about the marketplace and my convictions about what should be done correctly and what things shouldn't be done incorrectly. All these things, I've developed this opinion over 3 decades, and I'm not going to listen to somebody that just started up and they somehow know more about how I should behave or view the marketplace in their infancy as a couple months in observing price action. Or coming from another school of thought and having never really spent the full year in it. But they're not gonna change or impact my opinion about what it is I hold about the markets. And it won't be like that for you either. It's gonna be like, okay, your opinion, I understand it. I respect it, but I'm not going to do anything with it. So there it is. And I'm hoping that what I'm saying here tonight doesn't discourage, because like I said, I'm going to be talking to students that have done funded accounts next week. And you've already seen these individuals that I've already interviewed. And they're right from my private mentorship. Like, they paid me to learn what they do and have made money with it. I have more of them next week. If you have learned the 2022 model and you did not join my private mentorship, which no one can, it's not happening anymore. So just relax. You know, we're mentoring just like this now. If you made money and you've been profitable with your trading, whether it be with your own funds or through funded account companies, and you want to be interviewed, I'd love to sit down with you. But it just seems like that I'm only getting my private mentorship students, which unfortunately that gives the impression that nobody can be profitable like with the 2022 model, which that's not true. It's just that model really clicked for a lot of my students that were trying to find their own model. And mentorship, when they paid me, I was giving them everything that I was willing to share as components, but I also taught them how to take each component to build their own model. And for the students that were in that mentorship, I had a very loose overview discussed in a commentary about that very model. I was leading people to just do that very thing, like create that model. So I suggested the pieces, but I didn't put it out there in a step by step by step by step. And if anybody's out there telling you that they're going to sell you access to videos where I've done that, they're lying to you, because I didn't do that. And my mentorship students will tell you right now on Twitter that I did not do that. I called the market just like you see me do daily, every single day. I did live streams the first year, doing what you see me doing in these live streams, and the same type of attitude that I got from some students you still see in the community here. You didn't take any trades. You talked for 2 hours. You didn't take any trades. I called all the logic as to why the market should behave a certain way. That's important. You need to have all that. Otherwise, the entries won't make any sense. You won't know what to reach for. You won't know how to find your model. So opinions, they're always going to be held by other people. My opinion of funded accounts and those companies that offer them, I am personally not a fan of them. If my son turns it around and makes money, I'm still not a fan of it. I'm of the opinion that, yes, most of you that use them probably don't have the funds to go and do that. I understand that. But if you're going to do it the right way, so that way you can get something out of it. Build up enough scratch money, whatever, and go with a real brokerage firm. So that way, you know, it's your money. You have control. You're not limited to some unrealistic small little drawdown. Like, it always goes up the same amount. No matter how much you make, it's not increasing. It's always that small little ultra small stop loss. That's how I look at it. I look at that as a very, very, very tight stop loss. And look at how I teach. I don't teach you to do that, do I? I don't teach you to hurry up and ram that stop loss underneath a profitable position, being fearful that it's going to stop you out, because it's probably going to stop you out. And you won't be able to see what? The appreciation and the equity going higher. It stops you out too quickly because you're strangling the trade. That's what these funded account companies do to you. And anybody that wants to say otherwise, you're welcome to your opinion, but you're never going to convince me that it's anything but that. They're placing so many odds in your favor of failing. But they market it like, this is the greatest advantage in the world. Look at this and look at that. Look what we do. We provide this. You don't have the money, use our money. Really? That small, ultra small trailing stop loss, maximum trailing loss or something. I don't know the term. It's something like that. That is equivalent to a jammed up, super tight stop loss in a trend that you're long in, and it's going right below the last couple ticks. That's what you're doing in these funded accounts. And when you add more contracts, you're all but guaranteeing you're getting stopped out. And you're going to break a rule, and you got to pay a reset. It's like getting margin called, and you're paying for it, but looking at it like it's a good thing. I'm sorry if that ruffles feathers. I'm not trying to do that. And I know some people are probably already preparing some kind of tweet response, you know, this, that, and the other thing. It's my opinion. I've watched what's going on in my son's account. I've seen he's broken every rule. And two of those rules don't make any damn sense to me. You can't trade after 4 o'clock. Dude, what are you talking about? Like, if you have a runner and you leave a small portion on and it's an earning season, sometimes you have these really sudden boom, like they just, it'll happen. But you'll never have that ever if they tell you got to close a trade at 4 o'clock or whatever it is. I don't know. It's like 4 o'clock. He said he did something past 4 o'clock and it was a rule that they said it was broken. And he made money, hypothetically, because it went to his target, but he failed. Now, tell me in the real world how that makes any sense. That's like the same people out there that argue and say partial profits are stupid. Partial profits are 100% profitable. Like, it doesn't make any sense. Trading is hard enough already for new traders. It's already hard enough. Don't compound the difficulty by forcing your results to perform in a ultra trailed stop loss, which is what these companies are placing you underneath. They're charging you money to trade in such a difficult parameter if you're trying to trade with leverage. The way you beat it is don't use the leverage. That's the only way you're going to beat it. One contract, two at most, but one contract. Your losses won't be so large that you can't fix them easily, even with one contract. And they can't screw you out of that account that you're working towards getting funded or a funded account. Because that same account, you know, trailed stop loss thing, my understanding, I might be wrong, so I'm open to being corrected here, but it seems like that never goes away. So you're always going to have this limit of unrealistic drawdown that completely ends your career. When in a real account with your own money, you're not going to stop because you had a 5% loss. This is to be real. It's not happening. You're going to trade. So it's already making things that are difficult next to impossible for an impulsive gambler that doesn't have an idea how to trade or use a model. And that's why they are such a high rate of failure in that. That's why you don't see a lot of other people out there being interviewed. Yeah, you're seeing people interviewed. You're seeing people make money. But the ones that are really killing it, they're disciplined. They're not guessing. They're not gambling. They're doing things with a model. And they're not trying to blow up the account overnight. They're working towards building up incrementally and outpacing the cost that they know they're going to have to pay, and they're building it up. And I promise you, they probably have a game plan that they're doing that to take it from there and placing it with a real brokerage firm, which is what they should do. In my opinion, that's what you should do. Because tomorrow is not promised to no one. And that segment of our industry, that could change overnight. They could say, you know what? This isn't happening anymore. And they have to comply. Think about that. That would be upsetting now, wouldn't it? What if your frame of trading right now is only on the basis of funded accounts? And what would happen if they said, this is no longer allowed? You got to stop doing it. Shut down all operations. How would that impact your trading and your ability to make money? Something to think about. So, anyway, I really wanted to sit down and have like a kumbaya moment, you know, sharing a personal thing that you would never know about. Like I didn't need to tell you about my son. You don't need to know about that. It's none of your damn business. But it's useful as a mentor because I'm showing you that if you do all the wrong things, no matter who you are, what pedigree you come from, you're still not going to see the results you want. And I'm showing you a side of me that, you know, I'll probably regret it months from now because it'll be taken out of context and you'll probably be taken out of context tonight or tomorrow. Who cares? But I'm sharing my frustration. Like, I don't know how to fix it. Like, I can't do anything to change what's not being done or what's being done. And it feels very, I feel powerless, you know, in a way where I know my words and my instructions and my encouragement are not going to be helpful. He's going to do whatever he wants to do. And I'm trying to come to terms with that because, you know, they're all growing into their own adult. They're growing into their own person. And while they may have certain characteristics of me, they're all individual and they all have their own unique qualities that make them who they are. Even though they're my kids, they all have certain quirky little things that make them who they are. And, you know, frankly, I was hoping I was going to have a lot more influence, at least in this setting. And I'm discovering that my strength in what I thought was going to be my influential advantage to be able to guide them and avoid all the things that I know is problematic and prevent them from having all these problems and struggles and be easier for them to learn it. It's much like some of you. They just want to do it their way. And I guess in a lot of ways I can appreciate it because that's how I was. But I don't know. I mean, you sit down, you say, now watch this. This is the thing we're following. This is the list of procedures and protocols. And winning, winning, winning. Now you do it. Okay. Throw the piece of paper out the window. Let's start with a new language. Let's trade a different time of the day. Let's use a different market. What is going on here? What just happened? Like, who are you? Are you my boy? What's wrong with you? Who are you? You're an imposter. So, human nature, you know, it's a real thing. And dad doesn't fix it. You know, ICT isn't enough to overcome it. They have to break themselves. You know, they have to burn it down enough times and then sit there with the ashes, in the ashes, and come to grips with they were the ones that did it to themselves. They are the ones that are going to have to come out of all that, wash themselves of it. And that's what I had to do. I mean, I wasn't spared any of that. And you think that you're going to spare yourself that uncomfortable period because you're going to do it to yourself. It's some time in the future, you're going to eventually trade in a setting that is taking on real monetary risk and or trading in this pseudo, you know, environment of a funded account, trying to get funded where you have something to lose. What are you losing? The money you're putting into it. You got to pay that monthly due and you got to pay that reset every time you need to utilize it. But have you considered, for those of you that have done multiple resets over and over and over again, is there a line that you're not going to cross. I won't reset 7 times. I won't do it a 10th time. For some of you, I won't do it after 3 times. 3 times, I'm done. I'm just going to have to do something else. What is that limit for you? Have you considered what it is? Because if you don't have the right mindset and a predetermined exit strategy, like, when do you call it quits and say, okay, this endeavor, this approach to doing it isn't meeting what I need and I can't hit that objective. So therefore, I'm going to stop all funding to it, which is that's what an entrepreneur does. They say, I'm not going to waste any more money in this. This is not yielding a return for me. So I'm not going to water it because it's not going to produce any more fruit. So what is it for you that does that? Where's the limit that you won't cross? There's a number. There's an amount of money that you're willing to invest in it. And when you hit that number, I don't care what video I make or what I do in a live stream or somebody else does or whatever they're selling, you ain't never doing it again. Do you ever think about that? It should be something you have in mind, because you shouldn't treat it like a cable TV bill or your Netflix bill. I'm just going to keep making the payment. It'll happen for me one day. I'll eventually get what I need. Maybe. But in reality, some of you, it won't ever happen. And that's what makes me unpleasant as a mentor, because I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Some of you want to do this, but you don't want to work for it. Some of you want to do this, but you don't want to pay for live data. Some of you want to do this, but you don't want to invest the time into it. Some of you want to make money and replace your job, but you don't want to defer the things that's going to require your time to study. Your girl money on the weekend, that can't happen. All the weekend and over the week, going out to the clubs and hanging out with this one, hanging out with that one, and you should always be studying. Some of you ain't going to work for it. Some of you are going to say you're going to do it. You're going to talk a good game online with me and other people in the community, and you won't do anything with it. You can't pretend. You can't go through the process of pretending that you're going to do it. Pretending and going through the motions on social media. Yeah, I'm a trader. I'm a student. I'm a funded trader. I'm this and I'm that. Are you really working? Are you really studying? Are you really trying to prune all the bad things out of you that are character flaws? Keeping up with who is doing what on social media? Who's making money today and how much? Who had the biggest drawdown? Who lost today? These are all things that really don't do anything to make you better. And nobody's keeping score by that stuff. Nobody cares. Keep all the drama out of it. Whatever it is you're doing in trading, keep it out. That's why I literally cannot wait. I said this to my older students the other day. I said, I can't wait till November. I'm so drained by social media. I have channels that I follow on YouTube that are not even traded. Like, they're not trading channels. They're just, well, a lot of different things. I like certain car channels, homesteading YouTube channels. I listen to some Christian channels that, you know, follow things in the news and try to make a parallel to scriptures and things like that. And it's funny to see how wrong they are. But to read the comment section of everyone else's videos, and you could be doing something very wholesome, charge no money, kindness, polite, never even use a curse word, never talk bad about anybody else. And invariably, you'll see dozens of miserable people in the comment section attacking the person that's doing the video, saying they should have did this and said, why ain't they doing that? Or they're attacking other people in the comment section that are just being part of the community. And that's what I'm seeing more of. I'm seeing it in, you know, in public. Like I said this morning, you know, we were out shopping. And the rudeness of people is off the charts now. Madness. And I've always been an introvert. I might not sound like an introvert because I'm talking about something I love, which, you know, is the markets and such. But if you were to meet me in the public setting, you would never identify me as an Inner Circle trader. You would never say, that's that guy. Because I'm reserved. I'm quiet. I'm not trying to draw attention to myself. And I see how people are becoming much more toxic. And I want to be my old reclusive self in November. Like, I'm looking forward to that. Because the world's getting uglier and people are getting very, very agitated over the smallest things, which means that we're at a boiling point. And I don't want to talk about the topics. The last time I did, since I mentioned a specific person, they killed the stream and the space was ended. I didn't end it. It was ended. And I've contemplated talking about using my SoundCloud account for those types of discussions. I don't want to put them on here because they've already, and two times they've done this. And the last time I was on Twitter, the reason why I left Twitter years ago is because I was telling everybody in 2019 what we all went through with COVID and the whole world coming to a screeching halt and all that stuff. I didn't say COVID, but I said, you know, we got something coming bad. It's going to be worse than, you know, 9/11, and every country's going to feel it and yada, yada, yada. I was putting up posts and they weren't letting those posts go through. So that was the first time I ever felt like anything I say is being watched by people that can say, you're not allowed to say that. And I was the first time I've ever been censored. Like, I've never felt censorship before. So I felt uncomfortable with that. I was like, you know, I'm not drawing any more attention to myself with this. I said, I'm done. Nobody drove me off of Twitter. Nobody ever drove me off of Twitter, and nobody drove me off now, and they won't. I'm scheduling my departure. It's the second Friday of November of this year. That's when I'm leaving Twitter. My tweets will stay up. I've deleted no tweets. I don't edit. I don't have a payment with Twitter where I can edit my tweets. Everything is exactly how I made them. Typos, incorrect spelling, the whole thing. But I don't want to talk about some of the topics that I've done before in the past on this medium. Because I know it's under new management, but I'm not convinced new management is anything different. It's just another mask. So if I lose this account because they say I say too much or I talk about certain things, one of the concerns I felt uncomfortable when I learned that certain members of the United Nations were actually listening to me on the Twitter feed. And I'm just, you know, a guy that talks about the markets. You know, I'm not part of any kind of leadership like that. And why they would be wanting to listen to me and why they were in my 3-hour long Twitter spaces. Like, it would be one thing to say, okay, why is there a lot of people listening to this space? But they're in there the whole time. So that was a little unnerving. And then when I'm talking about things that are not real popular, and then I'm talking about certain subject matters, and then my Twitter space gets terminated. I feel like I'm back in that same spot again. So I'm not going to talk about those things here. I can talk about that kind of stuff on my SoundCloud, and it's not monetized. So it's not like me saying, come over here so I can make money. I'm not making money off of this. I want to do these things. I want to talk. I want to give you my opinion, number one. That's first and foremost. That's all it is. But I also kind of want to guide you through the growth and the growing pains that you're going to go through doing what it is that we do, learning something that's really incredibly difficult. And you have to submit through a lot of time, a lot more time than you want to put through initially. And it's a medium with SoundCloud. If they were to shut that down, I don't care. I don't care. But I have a voice here on Twitter that I want to keep until the end of the year in November. That medium I want to keep, so that way everything I said, it's archived here. It's public. Everybody can see what I called. Everyone can see what I was looking for real time. You can't hide it. I haven't deleted anything, and nothing's been changed. And nothing has been hidden from you. There wasn't a plan A, plan B. It's all here. The last time I left Twitter, I told everybody a week in advance. I said, I'm going to be removing my Twitter account. If you want any of my tweets, you have until Saturday to copy them. I didn't just pull the plug. I let everybody know this is the way it is. When I shut down my mentorship, I said, you have this many months to collect what you want because it's done. I didn't pull the plug like that. I'm telling you when I'm done teaching. It's the second Friday in November of 2023. I'm telling you when I'm stopping. So everything has always been this way. I've always done these things, but I don't feel comfortable talking about some of the things I felt I would be able to do because it was under new management on Twitter. And, you know, I don't view myself as someone that would be worth messing with. I'm just a simple guy. I got a very, very good skill set that I'm trying to share, and I'm trying to do it for free. And I'm trying to do it in a way where I can find it fun. It provides me a sense of satisfaction to stop people that have ripped off my content and tried to market it as their own, because now they can see that I'm the person that put that out there. And you all have the advantage of being with me for free and see if it's worth your time and investment in it. And if it's not, no harm, no foul. Good luck with whatever you do. But I don't want to put myself in a situation where, I was just going to say it. Some dude on Twitter posted something about a candidate in 2016, and you know, he's facing 10 years in prison for something that wasn't really all that big of a deal. In my opinion, wasn't. And we can't make a joke about anything. Like, you can't joke about certain things. You can't say certain things. And to me, we don't have freedom of speech if that's the case. Certain speeches aren't free. You're free to say whatever you want, but be prepared to accept the consequences of your free speech. So I'm not going to use this medium to talk about the things that in the past I used this medium for. So without losing my voice to you, about prompting you real time and being like I'm a friend, I can send you a text message. Like when I post a tweet and you're following me on Twitter, it's just the same as if I had your personal phone number and I sent you a message. Hey, look at the ES at this minute. this favor I got. It's like we're best friends. We've known each other for a long time, and I have your number. And I'm sending you a text message. I like that access to you because it's immediate. It's real time. And if I talk about something here, and I know some of you really want me to ramp that part of what I do up. I don't want to do that because it's getting, we're getting to Orwellian levels. And I don't want to be a voice that they say, yeah, this guy needs to be tapped and he needs to be told he can't do that anymore in a really convincing way. Like, I don't need you to do that. Like, I already see what's coming. And all those things that other people are enduring. You know, I have other things I got to do. I don't want to be bothered with all that crap. Now, I've already mentioned this stuff, you know, in 2016. I already laid all this stuff out and said what we're dealing with right now. It's happening. All that stuff I talked about and everyone made fun of me. And I didn't fully understand why I was saying what I was saying at the time. But it all came to pass. And is coming to pass right now. Like, we're seeing all this stuff. And I don't have an answer for it. Like, I know some of you have this real high and lofty opinion of me. I don't know. Like, I have no idea where to put the money I have. Because if things go where I think it's going, you know, it's going to affect everybody. And I don't believe crypto is the answer. I know some of you are probably already, you're typing out the tweet right now. Put it in Bitcoin, put it in Ethereum, put it in XRP, and XRP is going to be this, whatever. But buy gold, buy silver, buy this, buy that. You know, my trust is not in money. I don't have all the answers. The things I know about, I talk about. If I don't know something, I'm not going to talk about it. I'm not going to pretend that I do. Which makes me a boring kind of guy. And that's fine. I don't claim to know everything. But the things I talk about, I feel like I'm an authority figure on it. Otherwise, I'm not going to talk about it. That's why I sound arrogant, because it's really from a position and stance of authority. I know what I'm talking about. I show you, I prove it to you. You see the logic coming to pass in the charts. It's real time, right to the second, right to the minute, right then and there. But all this stuff that's coming down the pike, we're not getting into too many details. I mean, if you just take a look, and it's coming. They're not hiding it now. Your sense of freedom is about to be redefined. And I'm not sure that direction is something that we want to be going in. There's a lot of tension in the world. There's a lot of anger building up, and that's going to increase. And social media presents the perfect opportunity for two opinions to come together. And where it would have been fun in the past to rib another guy or girl and make fun of them and everybody laugh about it, and it's, you know, what it is, trolling. I was a troll. I don't want to do that now, because the consequences that they're placing on simple little gags, simple little things that, you know, that to rib another person or make fun of someone else or make light of something, they've turned it into a federal offense now. Oh no, you're talking about they did this and they did that. I know their argument's going to be in relationship to the guy who's facing federal charges for 10 years in prison for election interference. Listen, I understand the new generation are really not educated. They're not. And my oldest is my daughter. And I can tell you, college was the worst investment ever. Because her whole outlook, she likes socialism. And that's a point of contention for her and I. And we are not allowed to have certain conversations like that because my wife won't allow it. But she is indoctrinated in socialism. She's been taught that in college. That's what they were. They're breeding that mindset. And, it's unfortunate because I'm not a subscriber to that. I don't think that's the way any country should go. And every country that's done it falls. If you look at the order of events and how things transpired in Venezuela on a timeline basis, we're near the end of it. Venezuela used to be amazingly rich. It was one of the richest countries in the world. Everything was wonderful for it. And then they put their sights on it. And everything that's going on right now in America, we're following that script. Just like I said in 2016, we would be Venezuela 2.0. And it's repeating itself. Is it because I was clairvoyant? No. These game plans are the same rule book they work with all the time. It's the same stuff, but when they don't teach history anymore, you don't recognize it. You can't even buy the history books I have anymore. I'm going to get a list of names and people. What books do you have? Can you make PDFs of the book? No, I'm not going to do that. But I'm growing more and more uncomfortable. Whereas back then, and even in the early stages of all the stuff and the Corona stuff, I was bold. I would say whatever I felt like saying, and I didn't care. I don't have that same carefree view about it anymore. I'm not paranoid. I'm just not trying to draw more attention to myself than it's necessary. I have something I want to accomplish this year. And once I'm done, I want us to have the full, complete experience together. That way I haven't been hindered and nothing interrupted it. So I'm trying to stay in my lane. The break that I had during Passover was me basically trying to stay focused on what it is I'm trying to accomplish this year, get through it, teach you all what I want to teach, and present a way of study. That way people can come to that channel and that list of tweets that showed things in the past and learn from it. I mean, don't cost you anything. And if you don't like it after spending some time with it, that's fine. But it didn't cost you any form of sacrifice. You can test it. You can see it. You can see it's been proven. And other people have proven it works. So it's not a flawed logic. It's not a contrived logic. And I have a lot more people come in with the receipts that it works. And they're doing it with markets I don't ever really touch or talk about, which is, again, proof of transferred understanding and knowledge. So, anyway, there's a lot of things I want to talk about, but I can't do it on this medium. So, like I said, I'm probably going to start doing once a week some kind of I guess it would be considered my tinfoil hat discussions. And it's wonderful segregation from the trading discussions. So that way, if it's not your cup of tea, you have no business going over to my SoundCloud account. But if you like that type of thing, and you just want to hear what I'm looking at, what I'm pondering, what I've found interesting, noteworthy, or where my concern is, that's what I'll do over there. There is no ads. There's no monetization of it. And if for a reason that account gets taken down, which I can't even imagine why it would, but if it did, I don't care. It doesn't affect this platform here, which is what I'm utilizing throughout the rest of the year. So that's the business there. And I will, I guess, catch up with you on Monday. Try to have a relaxing weekend. Don't do too much studying. Have a little bit of a downtime and reset yourself. Until I talk to you next time, be safe.